I'm John Gaffer. I work for the Financial Times. And we're privileged, actually, this morning to have a distinguished panel to discuss the issue of financial market regulation. I think it's safe to say that we're at a historic moment. We don't exactly know what history will say about this moment, but we do know that it will at least record it and say that it was a turning point of some kind, both in the financial sector generally and in regulation particularly. And I'd just like to start, actually, by asking Steve Friedman the question. Everyone says now, given the extraordinary events we've been seeing, that we clearly need more regulation. Do we need more regulation?
I wouldn't phrase it as more, because it's an interesting irony that some of the parts of the system that blew up the earliest and really set off the conflagration were intensely regulated. I would say we certainly need more effective regulation. I think it would be very, very hard to make a spirited defense for the regulatory system that existed before. I think it's now become accepted wisdom that the U.S. has a hodgepodge of regulatory structures set up that were not designed for the 21st century. Indeed, they were. It was some form of congressional log rolling, giving everyone something that they wanted. And it's remarkably inefficient, and it allows things to fall between the slats. There just isn't adequate talent to go around it unless you concentrate your fire more effectively. So we need a totally rethought regulatory system in this country. I think there's a myth that capital markets people, of whom I am one, and a lot of the people in the audience are from that, basically think that the free markets are so perfect that they will be intricate self-regulating mechanisms. Just everyone in this room looks old enough to remember the events of the last 25 years. Go back to the Latin American debt crisis, the real estate crisis, and the bank crisis of the late 80s and early 90s, long-term capital, the dot-com bubble, the Asian debt crisis, and the current, which is by far the worst, and I've probably left some out. We have a financial system that in many ways is bipolar. It seems to range between heights of speculative euphoria and then depths of panicky despair and the drying up of liquidity and correlations gravitating towards one. And, that you don't have to be a great historian to know that's been the pattern over many, many, many centuries. You can go back to tulip bulbs and South Sea bubbles and the railroad bust-ups in the 19th century. So it seems to be something endemic in human nature. And we need a regulatory system that, without taking the risk-taking and creative genius of the system out of it, substantially moderates the highs and the lows. Needs to be completely rethought. The last thing I would say is, it is a frightening thought to me that Congress, without an immense preparation, would try to take on that job, trying to do it in a period where there would be thoughts of retribution and punishment and populism. The people have talked a lot about the Bretton Woods conference. It took several years of intense study before that conference, preparation by technicians, before the movers and shakers were able to move. And I think it would be very well advised for some kind of blue ribbon bipartisan group to be appointed by the new president, incoming president in Congress, to study this, let a little bit of time pass, and establish a template.
Bill Donaldson?
Yeah, I don't think it's a question of more regulation. I think it's a question of more effective regulation. As Steve intimated, if you go back to 1929 and the early 30s, formation of the SEC, the Securities Acts of 33 and 34, Glass-Steagall to separate investment banking from banking, All of these regulatory agencies were set up in 1930. You fast forward present time, the Gramm-Leach-Bliley law threw out Glass-Steagall and allowed everybody to get into everybody else's business, and yet the regulatory organizations were organized, the Federal Reserve to give prudent prudential regulation to the banking system, the SEC to be the policeman, if you will, the investors' protector. And what we need to do, I believe, is to totally rethink these regulatory agencies and to totally rethink what their responsibilities are going to be. Once we get that job done, we are not an island unto ourselves here in the United States. We're dealing on a global basis.
There's supervision, there's regulation, they're not the same thing. Supervision is qualitative, regulation is on, off, good, bad, yes, no. I'm a believer in supervisor coming out of the bank supervisory world. It requires talented examiners to go into institutions and examine them. The bank supervisors do that with varying skills. Too many federal agencies involved in bank supervision. 50 state agencies do bank supervision. 50 insurance state agencies. Federal level, the SEC, not too much involvement on the state level except for attorneys general. The greatest impediment to all of this, Congress. Agricultural committee has responsibility for futures. Do they want to give it up to a committee? And that has been an absolute difficulty for us, and maybe next year, the second half next year, we'll start to deal with that situation. Structurally, I look at the industries. We're too close to it right now to appreciate what has happened with a large number of non-banking organizations becoming bank holding companies under the Fed's umbrella. That's significant. It changes leverage. There's a leverage ratio. And I think it will take us a while to sort it out. We haven't really seen them restructure. You know, is there going to be a massive movement of assets from non-banking parts of those organizations into the bank? Well, those will really be mega banks. Long run, I can start with a long run and work back. I believe in universal banks. There should be a charter. You should be able to do whatever. Our competitors around the world, except Japan, which lags us in terms of following us, have universal banks. The bank can decide what it wants to do. You can be a consumer bank, you can be an investment bank, you can be an everything bank. It's up to management to decide that. Working back from that, there are difficulties with the number of agencies. I'll go back to short term. People say OCC, control of the currency, Office of Thrift Supervision, move them both together. Office of Thrift Supervision supervised AIG. That means that it would have looked at AIG financial products. Must have been a great job that they did. Once we can get step one done, and that there are other parts of it, I believe the Fed should end up with 25, 35, 50 of the largest systemic prone organizations, commercial banks, investment banks, hedge funds, private funds, whatever. And every year, every 3 years, that list change. And they come in under the Fed's prudential supervision. And we are perhaps the greatest principles over rules nation. I hear all the time that the FSA in London is has the best rules. Well, they have rules. They have 9 rules. If you can't find the answer in the 10,000-page rule book, you go to the 9 rules. In bank supervision, unsafe, unsound banking practice. New York banking law, turn of the last century. It's all the bank examiner has to say is this is an unsafe, unsound practice. Stop it. You don't stop it, you get spanked. That's the best rule that there is. What's unsafe and unsound? I know what it is. You know what it is. The one issue that I have concern with is the quality of staff necessary to do it. If you're going to rely on supervision as opposed to regulation, you need quality of staff. And that becomes a matter of payment, how much you pay people. At the New York Fed, when I was first vice president, my biggest challenge was, how do I keep someone 5 years instead of 3? How do I keep them 7 years instead of 5? How much good work can I throw at them? and how much money can I pay them within constraints, knowing that the private sector is much greater.